Hi, sir.
Hi, Sivan. Okay, Arjun. Arjun, Arjun.
So we are live already. This is
Okay.
being broadcasted right now.
Okay,
So
excellent.
yeah.
All our interns appear to be late, Latif, sir. By about 5:10, 5, quarter past 5 or so, they get warmed up, it seems. Hello, Slesha, Kavya, Kunal, Pratik, Ritvik, Sainath, Shriram.
Hey, I'm just trying to set this up on two machines.
Good. How come? Two machines?
Well, my laptop's camera is screwed.
Okay.
So I thought I'll do the presentation from my laptop.
Okay.
And use the camera for my mugshot. Use the iPad for my mugshot. But I am not sure.
Crosstalk of audio, basically, then.
Why is that? I can. Why is that?
You have to mute one of the audio, no?
I will mute one of the audios. Yes, I will mute one of the audios. But because this camera is not on, I'm not sure it's allowing me to share my screen.
Okay.
Where does what share screen here?
The bottom panel, right? Share content.
Yeah. In fact, you should be able to do that even without sharing video. Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah.
Are the interns not interested in learning about programming?
Just checking, YouTube stream has 17 people there.
Can you see my screen?
No, I can't.
Okay. Can I have multiple programs? Can I just share the screen instead of just specific applications?
Can you share the screen instead of a window?
Yeah. Guess not,
I believe their option is there, but Arjun has been playing around with it much more.
Yeah, that is possible. You should be able to share your screen on the entire screen.
Okay, it's right there. Okay.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, we can see it now. Yeah.
Hey, Sriram, I like the font. What's this font?
Economica.
Oh, nice.
The title is also suiting. Beautiful font.
It's all connected.
It's all connected.
It's all connected, I said.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
You know, like I tell this story that Apple's beautiful displays arose out of Steve Jobs' fascination for calligraphy.
Right, at Reed College.
Yes, he was very interested in calligraphy. So he thought, why can't we have these beautiful forms on the computer? Why do they have to be the teletype kind of very boring, nerdy engineering kind of fonts?
True.
And that's how Apple got its fonts and screens and stuff like that. There's another story that was shared with me by a friend called Janardhan Thakur, who was the editor of Free Press Journal. I wonder if I've ever told you that.
No.
He was on the banks of the Ganges, of the Ganga in Banaras, mm-hmm. in the late 60s. And he described the scene. And I'd just come back from abroad. So he was talking to me about computers and computer scientists, and that he might also know some people. And he said, you know, I met this very interesting hippie on the banks of the Ganga in Banaras, and we had a fascinating conversation about Indian mythology and history and culture and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And you know what? Recently, I read his name in the news. He seems to be quite well known now, right? And he said, have you heard of a guy called Steve Jobs?
That's insane.
Right? And that brings home to us that life cannot be lived in silos. And that's something which I've been trying to kind of share with our interns and the people that we engage with, that life cannot be lived in silos, number one. Number two is that you have to follow your passion.
True.
And I think you're a good example of that. So we'll hold you up to that also.
Oh, me? Okay. Never right? Too late.
Yes. So we'll wait a couple of minutes and then we'll get started. There's someone at the door, which I'll just see to you.
Hi Kavi, hi Shriram, Paritosh here.
Who's this?
This is Paritosh Pandya.
Hi Paritosh.
Hi Paritosh.
Hi Kavi, hi Shriram.
Good to see you.
Looking forward to this, yeah.
Indeed.
I'll shut off the camera, there's no need.
Sure, kya late ke dekh rahe ho?
yaar, kya karenge? Very laid back attitude to life. How are things?
Good.
Looking forward to this.
Let me turn this meeting thing on again.
So let me introduce Professor Paritosh Pandya, who is a good friend and colleague from TIFR in Bombay. Extremely well known in the area of real-time systems and scheduling, wrote amongst some of the earliest and most important cited papers on real-time scheduling and scheduling theory and so on. And he's a good friend of eYantra and has been an ally in whatever eYantra has done for some time. And he'll be working increasingly with us now.
Yeah. Thanks. Still trying to figure out the ways to build beautiful and robust systems. Don't know how.
Indeed. That's why we are all here to learn this today.
Yes.
We have another colleague here, Uday Ramtirthkar, who's bread and butter until recently when he retired from TCS. Has been building large systems, and the one that he was responsible for in TCS was Ignio.
Yeah.
Uday, do you want to just describe Ignio a little bit?
Yeah. So I've been with this and with TCS for 35 years, and last almost 7-8 years I was with this product Ignio. Essentially, it is a AI plus automation product, which we have deployed at around 100 customers. Mainly to, initially we started with automation as a goal, the entire data center infrastructure automation and all. But later on we introduced analytics and AI part. And this topic is very relevant to me because deploying Ignio at many sites, we really struggled, still continue to struggle. Because the whole nature of tool as well as the target systems are very, new as well as the load and all these not very envisageable. And that becomes a problem, and whole system around it. It takes around 1 or 2 months to stabilize before we can go into production. Till last minute, when I retired in February, till last day, we were managing many customers and trying to resolve problems. And struggle continues. So, topic is very much dear to me.
Thanks, Uday. You are setting up this topic pretty well. So maybe it's time we should start. I would request everybody to just mute their mics because we are getting some extraneous noise from here and there. It kind of distracts a little bit. And you can mute your video also because that could also get distracting. So without much ado, let me get down to introducing our speaker today. But more important first, let us introduce why this topic has been chosen. So in the eYantra robotics competition year after year, we see a lot of kids who come and build their robotic systems and come and we feel so bad when the system, which apparently they say worked beautifully before they came, they come to IIT and it just doesn't work, right? Something as basic as line following doesn't work. Or typically what happens is that some little bracket on their robot got bent in the transportation, in the train or whatever it is. And at IIT, it doesn't work because some calibration has gone for a toss. And when we ask these guys, what happens is, sir, it was working in my college, right? And I don't know why it's not working here. So you ask him, how many times out of 10 was it working in your college? He says, 7, 8 times it was working. Now, we always tell these guys that that is not good enough, right? If you want it to work, it should work 10 out of 10 times. Only then you have something worthy enough to bring to a competition. Now, this does not happen by accident, right? The reliability and ruggedity of a system is not an accident. It's actually an engineering activity. And software, unfortunately, because people think it's so easy to just recode something and make it work again, we are very indisciplined. And for the last 30, 40 years, I have not seen that much dramatic change in software tooling as one would have expected from all the promises 30 years ago. And unlike other professions, like when an engineer builds a bridge, right, they build in a certain redundancy into the build, maybe 100% or whatever it is. And okay, if you take even 1.5 times the amount of maximum traffic that you expect on the bridge won't fall down. Software engineering is the only profession where you build a big imarat, a building, right? And sometimes when the whole edifice falls down, we kind of refuse to take the responsibility. We say that, oh, it's a bug. As though a bug has crept in from somewhere, you know, it's an unhygienic place. It's kind of crept in from somewhere and it's destroyed the system. The bug is actually our lack of understanding of the way the system behaves or interacts and stuff like that. And how to make it interact better in a more reliable and in a more predictable way is what I think Shriram is going to talk about today. And it's not something that we can leave to chance, but he'll acquaint you with the richness of the problem of building beautiful systems. And beauty is not a luxury, actually. He'll discuss that, I'm sure. So a little bit about Shriram. Professor Shriram is adjunct faculty in our Department of Computer Science at IIT Bombay. He's originally a mechanical engineer. That's what makes him a bit unusual, who took a BTech in mechanical engineering and then went on and did a PhD at the University of Cambridge in the UK in computer science. And he's been the technical architect and developer since 87 of several highly scalable and low latency, important, low latency distributed transactional systems with a lot of patents to his name in this area. So he's done kind of hardcore kernel level work for embedded systems and for of communication stacks and stuff like this. And he's an expert in what we call large scale distributed systems, right? Functional reactive design, low latency transactions, compiler designs, you know, networking protocol design, all the kind of, you know, heavy duty engineering that goes into building, say, a Dropbox system or a Google storage system or what have you, right? And apart from that, he's passionate about programming. He's mastered 64 languages and counting and so on. And he's designed and delivered lots of commercial systems over the last 25 years, from embedded sensor networks to application server frameworks. In fact, one startup or one web company that he was principal engineer to was WebLogic, which did some very, very foundational and seminal work in this low latency web transactional business many years ago. And he's built large applications like flight and product movement planning systems for FedEx and stuff like that. He's also written a best-selling book, Advanced Perl Programming, right, which had played a part in the rise of the early web. He's a core contributor to the Bloom language implementation, and he's designed and developed a power-aware, secure cryptographic solution for wireless sensors that are embedded in roads and highways. So he's got a very rich experience, and we are all looking forward. In fact, this talk came up saying that I asked him, Sriram, our kids find it so difficult. They feel that just writing a program is as good as just hacking some code, and as long as it works and gets the job done, that's the end of the story. And they don't realize that this is what leads to a lot of problems. I'm sure that's not how your printers and mobile phones are built, because you expect it to work 100% of the time, right? So this is what Professor Sriram will be speaking to us today about. So over to you, Sriram.
Thank you for the kind introduction. You can hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. So I was trying to figure out, this is obviously a pretty large topic, and I was going to cherry pick a few things and put it under this topic. For me, a product is satisfactory if it is beautiful and it's reliable. And like a well-done chef's knife, or a samurai sword, or a car door that goes ka-chunk, and you can feel the heft of the car, of the door. There's beautifully designed things, the iPhone, the Samsung Galaxy, there's things that are beautiful and robust. So I wanted to see what a few things about some patterns that might help us in software to develop both beauty and robustness at the same time without sacrificing either. So we can sort of we can agree, I guess, that this is a beautiful car, this is a Maserati. But if you look at the reliability indexes, it's right at the very bottom. Let me see where the pointer is. It's right at the very bottom, Maserati. And you might be surprised that all the German brands, whether it's Mercedes or BMW or Audi or Porsche, they're all in the bottom quartile of reliability. And Germans are supposed to be known for their engineering, but it turns out they are hopelessly unreliable, or they cost too much to repair, or parts are not available. So effectively, as far as I'm concerned, does it give me the warm, fuzzy feeling to own a car like this that might break down, that's flaky? Suddenly the shine comes off of the purely the aesthetic beauty. So what I would like to have is not just superficial beauty, but a beautiful experience of somebody who owns a car or interacts with that product. How do you deliver a beautiful experience? Now, of course, depends on who you are, and you define what beautiful experience means to you. When they say beauty lies in the eye of the beholder, in fact, I heard a joke that says beauty lies in the eye of the beer holder. It depends on how much you've had to drink. So it entirely depends on who views this and what their metrics are for what makes for beauty. So if you say, there are different kinds of stakeholders. There are different kinds of stakeholders in a software, in a product, I guess. There are users, there are beginners to experts, there are developers and maintainers, there are testers, there are operations people, and there are on-site repair people or on-site debugging people. So you ask each of them, and they'll have different sets of things that give them the warm fuzzies about why they like a particular product or why they dislike a particular product. And we are trying to sort of cater to all of them, right? So aesthetics, the look and feel, is just one category. The aesthetics can be, the choice of fonts and colors on the documentation on the website, on how beautifully the code is structured. That is one part. But reliability, I mean, a product can be, you know, okay looking, but if it's rock solid, you'll say, wow, it's a beautiful product. I love it. Right? The word beautiful is used in the experience, not just the looks of it. Or how usable is it? How testable is it? Monitorability, debuggability. There are lots and lots of abilities, right? Capabilities. So how do you develop software that is at once beautiful to look at? Is it reliable? It's testable, it's monitorable, it's repairable, it's understandable, it's predictable. And predictability is a very big thing, right? So how do you develop software? Now, clearly, this is a very big mandate. What I did was I looked at the UIRC code and looked at various examples, said, what kind of principles would I apply to improve them? So I took that angle to filter out a clutch of techniques, right? So this is what I'm going to focus on. A bunch of functional principles. This is just an overview of what's to come. How do you create reactive state machines? How do you eliminate code? And how do you make the machine do a lot of the work, right? So along these four categories is there are plenty more, but I thought this would be a good start. So let's without further ado, let's start with the functional principles. The first principle is that when you write functions, the functions must be pure. Strive to make your functions pure, which means that the output of the function must depend purely on the input arguments and nothing else. No global variables, no contextual variables from outside that environment, right? No environment variables, for example. No hardware reading as far as possible, right? If you're computing something based on hardware, then let the hardware reading be elsewhere. But the computation part could be a pure function. And additionally, there should be no side effects as far as possible. So one quick way to spot this is one anti-pattern is if you see a void in the input or output, then you know something's wrong. So for example, one of the code pieces I found was the find shortest path with void and void input and void output. So here you say find shortest path, it takes nothing and produces nothing. What is it really supposed to do? Gives me no clue what it is supposed to be doing. Maybe it's launching a nuclear missile on the shortest path. Who knows what it's doing, right?
Shriram, is a very important point here. I'd like to highlight to everyone that Shriram actually took the trouble to go through the eYantra competition theme submissions. He went to the GitHub code, and these are the observations from that. Shriram, if you clarify that, it'll be nice.
Yes. So this is from EYRC 2019. So if you see your code here, please don't consider it as a personal attack. It's just a they're just observations, and there are mistakes, I would say, that are there in pretty much all the code that I have seen. So like common patterns, that's what I have worked towards. Okay, so don't take it personally. So as an alternative to this find shortest path, here is an alternative which says, here's a graph G from node to node, find the shortest path, and it gives me back a path. This is a pure computation. Now, let me see if I have this somewhere. No, I don't have it here, but well, you get the picture. I was going to actually show a bit more of the code, but I'll get back to this point later on. Okay, so find shortest path is from just the inputs to the output.
You.
What I've seen in some of this code is that people, for example, give an image as an input argument. And it seems to me that that's not what a find shortest path is all about. So that brings me to the next, sorry, that brings me to one more functional principle. In fact, I was say, I'm sorry, I'm losing my train of thought here. So the first is pure functions. Get back to find shortest path. in a bit. Okay, the second functional principle I'd like to mention is, as far as possible, avoid in-place mutation. Now, for those of us who have our formative experience in typical languages like JavaScript or Python or C or C++, we are used to modifying variables, we are used to modifying data structures in situ. And for large systems, it really creates a lot of problems. A lot of problems. So in this example here, this is a Python example, A is assigned hello, then B equals A. Then to B, I append by. Now if I print A, because A and B are aliased, it prints hello and by, because A has been modified as well. Now, this is not a problem because you're able to see the code right here. But if you were to pass this A to a function, and if it were to append something, the input argument has now been modified. It's no longer just an input argument. Right? And that can cause for great surprise. So aliasing is a huge issue in the correctness. In fact, it is probably the central issue for mistakes I would say it's about like 90% of all the errors in C, C++, Java code are because of this aliasing issue. You know, one part of code is hanging onto a pointer, and the code uses an alias to that same object through some other name and modifies it. And the code that is pointing to this with this one, with this other variable, is suddenly surprised. And often, when it's concurrent code, that's a cause for surprise. It's like, suddenly, where did that change underneath? Right? You don't expect. So you can do all the locks, and you can follow all the semaphores and locking protocols you want, but it'll get under the radar. So testing is a pain. So if you can avoid in-place mutation, it's actually works out really well. And you might think that this is a performance issue. And strangely enough, it's not. And now there are languages like Rust, for example. I don't know how many of you use Rust. The default is immutability. You cannot modify. You have to explicitly say it's going to be mutated. And then the type system kicks in and says, if one guy is holding on to a pointer to an object and that he has the rights, that particular piece of code has the right to modify it, then no other piece of code has a right to modify it at the same time. At compile time, the Rust language compiler takes care of that. We don't have any such protection with the type systems in C and C++ and in Java and JavaScript and so on. So it's worth looking at these kinds of languages. And it's not a performance issue, even if you were to duplicate these things. You look at a language like Erlang. Now, this is a language that is, it is a completely interpreted language. It is used inside some of the most robust telecom switches in the world with almost 99s reliability. That is 99.9999999+7 9s following percent reliability. Right? It'll go out for a few seconds every year. That is a guaranteed thing. It's a scripting language which does not allow mutation. So if you think that performance is a big issue, it's not really, for the most part. You'll be surprised. It's something like YouTube, for example, runs on Python. Dropbox runs on Python. So only small pieces of very, very performance critical code needs to be written in C++. For everything else, you can afford to choose slower but better idioms, right? So let's look at a way how you avoid in-place mutation in Python. So you can use something called functional data structures. They're also called persistent data structures or multi-version data structures or immutable data structures. When I say persistent, it does not mean persistent to disk. It means persistent as in that object, its value is persistent. It's not going to change. It's immutable. So Python has a module called persistent. It's a module that you have to import, to install. It's an external third-party module. So you say from persistent import v. V is a vector, okay? So you create a vector, a equals v, 1, 2, 3. And same way, you say b equals a, and c equals b dot append 10. What b dot append does is it creates a new vector altogether, but in a very efficient way underneath. Okay, it is not simply shamelessly clone the entire object. There are ways of doing these things that, and I will show you references, which can be very efficient, and they are very, very close to native built-in data structures. So you have vectors, you have maps, you have sets, all kinds of data structures. So in this case, if you say print A and print B, they have not changed. Even though you did a B dot append and A is alias to B, neither B nor A have changed. It produced, B dot append produced a whole new vector, which if you print it, it'll be 1, 2, 3, 10. So what happens is, if let's say you have two threads, you know, in concurrency, if I'm assuming you know what threads are, let's say you have an interrupt service routine and you have normal code, which are basically two threads. One guy is, you know, pointing to an object, other guy comes along and says, change this. But it's not really changing it. It's creating a new copy for himself. It's a completely private new copy, right? So this pattern is used, you would be surprised how much it's used in real systems. So here's an example of how you would create a persistent tree. So let's say you have a tree of this sort, and let's say a binary tree, and let's say you have to insert 8 in this. So clearly the 8 will have to go here, right? Here's where 8 will come. Now, in a conventional tree, you would mutate this node and create and change its right child pointer to point to this node, to this newly created node. So you'll create a node 8 and modify this 7 right child to point to this 8, right? This is what you would do in a normal mutating sense, so in place mutation. Whereas if you were to follow the persistent data structure, what you would do is create a whole new tree starting from the root. Here's what it looks like. So this is the old tree. This is the new tree. The new root, which is root prime, has, again, as usual, starts at 10. Its left subchild, a left child, points to a tree, which is the old tree, old subtree. So only part of it has been copied. Its right subchild is a new node 7, whose left child is reusing the old node. And now it has a new child 8. So this thing is actually a complete tree with the new element 8. Parts of the old tree have been used for structure sharing. So this is called structure sharing. So you have essentially two trees now that exist. Simultaneously, they exist. And whoever has access to this root prime gets to see only the new tree, whereas somebody else who is probably traversing through this old tree will not get to see an 8. So it's as if he's seeing an earlier snapshot. So in one fell swoop, you've created a snapshot by creating a whole new tree without cloning every single thing. You didn't do a deep clone, right? This is an example of a persistent or an immutable or a functional tree. So at most you will have, if the h is the height of the tree, just log n of the order log n, where n is the number of nodes, you will have that many. For every insert will cost you log n new nodes, okay? Now, what happens to this thing? I mean, now these nodes may not be used anymore. That's what garbage collection is for, right? If the garbage collector in a language notices that you've not been seeing these, you're not looking at these objects, then it'll get garbage collected and only the new tree will be there in place. If you have any questions now, I can take this. I'll move on, and perhaps Kavi, you can take a look at the chat, and you can, tell me.
Yeah, I'm monitoring that. It's too early. It's very clear until now.
Okay, cool. So this is a persistent tree. Now this is an example of a multi-versioned state. So this is the old version. This is a new version. Right? Now there are two threads. One thread could be traversing this. It could be doing an infix traversal. And here you have a new tree. So you are now handling concurrency without doing any locks, because the new version is immutable. All the versions are immutable. So nobody needs any locks. There's no write lock, there's no read lock. The only time you want to say, what is the latest version? So you have one variable which is, say, it's called latest, and latest is made to point to 10. If somebody modifies that and creates a new tree, latest will point to that tree. And that is where you can do an atomic swap of a pointer. Just switch the pointers around, and that is one machine instruction. You don't need locks, right? So at the expense of creating more objects, you have actually created a much simpler locking discipline, concurrency discipline, much simpler. And in general, there are languages like Haskell and Scala and Rust and all these guys. They give you persistence out of the box, closure, and you must learn one or more of these languages to get a feel for what it means to work with these kinds of data structures. So multi-version state is everywhere in real systems. So Git, of course, its whole job is to have multiple versions. But all modern databases supports what is called snapshot isolation, or they are multi-version. Earlier, every key had a particular value. So there, for a given primary key, you have one row, right? But in modern databases, you can have multiple versions. So it is possible that you have, so what the databases give you is snapshot isolation. Just like we saw in the earlier example, you have access to a version, a snapshot. What you have is that you have two versions of the same primary key. If there is an older transaction that started earlier and started traversing the database, it is as if it is working on its own private snapshot. Meanwhile, other clients are inserting things, but the older state, the older transaction, gets to see a consistent, fully consistent state, as if it had access to a complete snapshot of the entire database when it started. Isn't that beautiful? And this can be done very, very efficiently, very efficiently.
So Sriram, I think you've highlighted something which is a very fundamental construct, which is not taught and which is not highlighted. I don't think any undergraduate or even postgraduate curriculum addresses these kind of paradigms or issues in even a programming course.
That's right. So in fact, this has been my biggest beef with data structures courses. Data structures are always all about in-place mutation. But the moment you put them into real systems and you put in concurrency, it's a completely different ball of wax. You can study about B-trees, as a procedural code, and then you put in concurrency and you have multiple, threads and multiple transactions coming into the mix. It's a complete mess. So the way you create, the way you have data structures in the real world, in a multi-user, in a concurrent world, a multi-chip world, is a problem. Any question?
Okay. I think not. But I think this is good. Paritosh, your mic is not muted, so we are getting some disturbance there. Paritosh, we are not getting any audio from you. Are you asking a question? Do you want to ask it in chat?
No, I'm just seeing you.
Omkar, okay, so you're asking something? If they can just ask it in chat, that will be good.
Okay, yeah. So
I'll interrupt you, I guess, if you get some questions. But this is an important point. If you can just highlight, say, in a system like Google Drive, how it uses this fundamental, concept in its implementation of Google Drive.
See, it's not so much the implementation. It's the mindset where if you say a file system has only one version of a file, and if you delete it, you had it, or you modified it. Like if you say Command A or Control A and you deleted the file, you say all the content is gone. But if you had the mindset that any mutation to a file is essentially a new file, this is not a new concept, right? Wax VMS had it in the 70s, right? IBM mainframes had these in the 60s, or actually in the 70s too. VMS probably was the first one to have a versioned file system. So Google Drive basically says that any change you make, it's a new version. The only difference that Google does is when you are given a URL, that is your latest pointer all the time. And the owner of that URL has access to earlier versions. But the URL only refers to the latest version. So if you have, you will never have an oops moment, because you always have the earlier, you can always go back in time on a Google Drive. So it's just a mindset. If you say copy on write, that is a classic paradigm in the Linux kernel. Right? There are data structures called, there's a set of locks called read, copy, update locks, RCU locks in the Linux kernel. They go on the basis that you have to have multiple versions. You have multiple versions that are available for reads, because different threads might be reading a particular version of a data structure, because there's a lot of stuff to read. They might be traversing a list. But once they are done, it says that I'm done with this version, and the kernel notices that nobody else is looking at a particular version. It automatically deallocates that list. So garbage collection, because it's not automatic in C or in the kernel, it has to be explicitly declared that you're done. Yes.
Paritosh has a question. He says level of atomicity,
yes,
at consistency is enforced is also important, right? So how does the programming language deal with that?
So how does the programming language deal with that? So when you say you are able to make an atomic change, there are two levels at which you can do an atomic change. One is you change a pointer. I'm looking at more from the point of view of machine architecture. You say this was a version and now this is a version, right? You're able to switch a pointer. Now, in Java, for example, there's a java.atomic concurrent.atomic package, and you can basically say change, swap the pointer. So you can have one variable that's always looking at the latest version, right? But then you have the concept of transactions, which have multiple changes. So it's not like you can say, I want to change this, and I want to change this, I want to change this. Now, clearly, this cannot be done as one atomic entity. So there are languages like Haskell and Clojure that define this out of the box, where you have software transactions. And in fact, the Intel has actually played around with hardware transactions as well, where they say that these are the changes that your thread is making or your core is making to a particular memory location. But it's actually not making changes to memory location. It's actually making changes to a log. And then when you say, OK, now I'm ready to commit this transaction, all the changes that you have made to a particular memory, to all the memory locations, they are done in one instant. And that hardware, that's something that the hardware takes care of by making sure that it follows not a two-phase commit protocol, but a more electronic level protocol to make the change atomic. So if I say I want to change this value to 10 and this value to 20, and I want all or nothing, so either the whole operation fails or the whole operation succeeds, right? Just like in a database transaction, then there are primitives both in languages like Haskell and Clojure, where we can do this in software. There are primitives in Intel Haskell architecture, where you can actually do it in hardware. Without that support, you really can't do it in C and C++. I mean, you can do it, but it's really ugly because the mindset is all mutation oriented. Now, if you were to do all of this using persistent data structures, it makes the job whole lot easier because you're not then modifying in place anyway. Does that answer your question, Paritosh? Okay, moving on. The third functional principle is separation of concerns. Now, this is actually a standard software engineering principle that I've seen, that each function should do one thing and do it well. So let me see some code here. This is one code. It says solve maze. Now, when you look at a solve maze, Is this clear, or should I zoom it further? Okay, clear. Okay.
It's clear. It's
Okay. So here you have solve maze. You've taken a binary image, a point, a final point, cell height, and the number of cells in the width. And the first thing it does is it creates a connection graph. So that points to me that really, when you're going to solve a maze, if you're going to create a graph, then there must be it can be nicely split into two things. It says convert the image to a graph, and after that, your only currency is the graph. You're only working when you say solve maze, you should be able to get. You should say here are the coordinates of the initial point and the final point. Here is the maze, and out comes a path which joins the coordinates, right? Complete. It has got nothing to do with pixels. And once you do that, that's a maze solving thing that you could apply elsewhere. You don't have to hard code it to an image. And I have seen that in the part that does image to whatever manipulation, there are many places where there's a dependence on, say, CV2 or OpenCV, right? It is not complete. It's completely unnecessary. How you got hold of those pixels should be completely outside that function. So as far as possible, make the function do one thing and do it well. That's a separation of concerns thing that I wanted to bring out. The next thing that I want to talk about is reactive state machines. So one of the things that I've seen is procedural code. So I'll just take a simple thing which says like procedural code to blink an LED every 10 seconds. So it starts off with the state false, and while true, it flips the state. And the new state is true, then turn on, else turn off, and it waits 10 seconds, and in a loop it goes down. Okay, this is the standard procedural code. There is a lot of this in all the bot code, where you say forward, and then it basically goes in a while true or a while one loop, doing just that. Now the problem with this is that this is not composable. You can only blink a light. In this case, you can only blink a light, and nothing else. So if somebody were to say press a cancel button, or if you have to read the state of the hardware and do something else, that something else will have to be incorporated into this loop, because now you have to do two things, right? You have to look for you have to blink the light every 10 seconds, but you also have to do this other thing. And now you can no longer just hard code the wait 10 seconds part. So the scheme quickly breaks apart if you have to do two concurrent things. And in real life, you will have many concurrent things to do. So one way to do this is to say convert all procedure, all such code where you might have to, is a state machine, and you convert it to a state machine where every part is possibly concurrent with another state machine. So here's what I mean. Here you have a while loop. What if you reimagine this code without the while loop? That is, the while loop is outside, the driver is outside. Here's what it might look like. So you have some code which has on timer event, and there's a self which is the state object itself. So somebody is calling state dot on timer. So it flips its, I'm sorry, it flips its state. Self dot is light on is not self dot is light on. So it flips its state, and if the light is on, then it invokes turn on. Otherwise, it invokes turn off. Then it restarts the timer. So here it doesn't wait, because you have a piece of code that is supposed to return to its caller, and it's all it does is restart the timer. At some point, somebody will prod the caller to make it call on timer event again. But until then, because you have returned to the caller, it is free to do other things. So each part, it's doing its own thing. It's just sort of each part is moving the pieces or changing a bit of state and doing something. So in this case, the doing something is the turning on and turning off part. So this would be a clearly a reactive state machine, because it's reacting to events, updating its state, and turning something on. And hopefully this is not some make this will not this is not something that's going to freeze the machine for a while. Now, this is, you will know this paradigm from any UI programming because it's a completely reactive state machine. So if you press a button, you don't want that button to do something that's computationally heavy, right? On the button event, you don't want that on button event to just block waiting for 10 seconds. Then the whole UI is frozen, right? So you have to learn to write many such loops, break it up, send the loop outside, and react to an event, right? So you're rewriting it in terms of a state machine. But there are still some problems with this reactive state machine as well. Now, here you can see that if you have two things going on, so if the, let's say, if the robot has to move and blink its LED every 10 seconds, this is nicely incorporated because it can do two things at the same time, right? Thoda khao, thoda phenko type. Thoda, you know, move ahead a little, blink the LED, move ahead a little, blink the LED, do whatever, in whatever order, it doesn't matter. But there is a problem here. It makes too many assumptions. It's not functional enough, and it's not testable enough. So one of the things, when you say separation of concerns, when you say pure functions, the nice thing about it is that these are individually testable. They are individually understandable, independent of whatever the environment might be. Here, this turn on, if it's part of the state machine code, it might be hard coding something that is, you know, robot specific, you know, turning on a particular port, a particular pin, and stuff like that. That does not really belong here on the timer event. Turn on really should not be called. So it's one thing to say that all that code has been encapsulated into turn on, but the question is, where should it be called? And my suggestion is, don't even call it here, because the state machine is then is not independently testable without the hardware. Right? You have to mock, you have to have a sort of an artificial turn on message method to help you with the testing, and that's not a very good architecture. You want to strive towards making it more and more testable. Okay, so here's how I would change it as a functional reactive state machine. In fact, this was one of the things that Kavi, in fact, pioneered. His thesis pioneered functional reactive animation. And the beautiful thing about it is that it's very, very composable. You can have many, many animations going on, like one triangle moving here, one rectangle moving there. And they're all completely composable in one movie, so to speak. So the functional reactive code looks like this, to blink an LED every 10 seconds. What it does is it creates a new state. So it does not modify its own state. It creates a whole new state. First of all, it's immutable. Then what it does is it returns two commands. So the first command is a string which says turn on, else turn off. And the second command is a new alarm. Right? It just says wake me up after 10 seconds. Those are the two commands. And it returns the new state, and it returns a list of these commands. Now, what this means is that this is completely functional. You can call this method over and over and over again, and all it'll do is it'll take that event and return a new state and a bunch of commands to do. Now, how that command is interpreted by the environment, whether it's running on Unix or whether it's running on a robot, completely independent. What does it mean to turn on a light? Completely independent of the state machine, right? It does its one nice thing, which is just the state machine part. And I use this as a way of encapsulating protocols, of network protocols, where I say, here's the kernel of the protocol state machine. It's got nothing to do. It knows nothing about the operating system. It knows nothing about the timer code. All it does is it says, I have received this many bytes. I'm responding to this. This is what you need to do. Send this chunk, send this message to this server, send this message to this server. That's the action. The code that surrounds it. So there's a kernel state machine and there's a code that surrounds it. That takes action on that state machine. It takes those list of actions and does the needful, right? Actions are basically just events going the other way. They are just events to the environment, right? It's a very simple topic, concept. So I just distinguish between incoming events, which I call event, and outgoing events, which are called actions, right? you can, so the thing is, this is completely repeatable. And when in network protocols, when I do it, I can simulate multiple servers, like basically have three such state machines. And this guy says, you know, send a message to this state machine. So what I do is I take the event from here, plonk it into this state machine and see how it behaves. And so I can completely simulate a random interaction just by poking one guy, taking his output, putting it to some other state machine, and letting it react, and so on, until the whole system sort of quiesces or stabilizes, right? And I see if any invariants have been broken. So the advantage is that this is testable with different states. There are zero side effects. There's no dependence on hardware. It's very, because it's concise, it's very easily understandable. And it lends itself to randomized testing, which I'll cover very shortly. Okay, so the next thing that I've seen, I'm done with functional principles in general. There's a very famous author and designer called Antoine de Saint-Exupéry who said that a designer knows he has achieved perfection, not when there are any features left to add, but when there's nothing left to take away. It is as concise as it gets, right? We need to eliminate code. And I wanted to sort of introduce you to different ways of eliminating code. Some, of course, you know, like refactoring is a classic, you know, it's a standard software engineering principle. So here, let's see if I have that. So here I've seen some code. This mid sensor and this is right sensor. The only difference between this is this byte. Really no other difference. Clearly, this can be encapsulated into one, right? So this is what I mean by refactoring it so that you eliminate all redundancies. The second thing that you may not be doing easily, and I've seen that in your code you don't do it, is to move to higher level languages and tools. So there are domain specific languages you are already aware of, you know, like VHDL you might be aware of, or Yak you might have studied perhaps in your compiler design or finite automata classes. You have regular expressions. These are all domain specific languages, which allow you to specify something at a very high level, and it generates a code for you. So when I say eliminate code, I mean, in this case, I'm meaning eliminate handwritten code where you're liable to make mistakes, or where you're liable to cut and paste and make a mistake, right? You are supposed to, you know, you duplicate something and you're supposed to change two things, and you forgot and you just change one thing, and now it doesn't behave the way it expects, you expected. So Estoril is a language that, you know, Paritosh and Kavi are experts at. If you're doing any embedded systems work at all, you should familiarize yourself with Estoril, definitely. There are the semantics, the way the code operates, the behavior of the code is very, very, very deterministic in Estoril, which is what gives it its power. I mean, there is non-determinism possible. But one of the things that you really want for reproducibility is code that just works the same way every single time. Right? There should be no surprises. So there are high-level tools that allow you to do that. So there is a state chart tool that I think many of you might on Yantra might be using it. This is a way to write state machines, but draw it on a screen. And so here you have a motion sensing light switch. This is one of the examples that it comes with. And the academic license is free for the fully loaded, powerful version. And the standard license is free for any non-commercial use. So here you have, you know, you can say things like, you start off with, let me see, so you start off here, when you enter this state, the motion sensing state, you start off in the state off, and you set the brightness to zero. And if it senses any motion at all here, sensor motion, if that event comes in from the sensor, So how do I know it's a sensor? There is, to the outside world, there is a, on the left-hand side, if you see interface, these are the different objects. There are the different entities in the environment that it says, I'm getting an event from this object. So it's basically, this, you can see this clear separation of concerns. It says from the sensor, if I get a motion event, then on entry, I switch over to the on state and set the brightness to 1, right? And if there's more motion, I continue to keep in this state. And it says after 30 seconds, it goes back to being off. So it's a motion sensing thing. But if I'm in this mode, and if the user actually presses an on button, then it goes into manual mode, and it sets the user brightness to 1. I'm looking at the right. And if you keep pressing that on button, it keeps increasing the brightness. So for every event, it keeps increasing the brightness. And now if I press off, then it goes back into motion sensing mode. Right? So it's a hierarchical state chart, which says from motion sensing, it's got nested states. So when I press the manually, if I press the button, then it goes from motion sensing to manual state. And if I press the off button, then it goes into wherever I left it at. Okay. Now, just this, if you press one button, it'll produce a whole bit of, you know, Python code or C++ code or JavaScript code or Ruby code. There are lots of code generators available. And you can play with it, right? So this is a higher level of thinking. This is one way of eliminating code. That's the whole point. The time is 5:57. Okay. So moving to higher levels, the next topic I'd like to talk about, introduce you to, is called fuzzing. Now, I have seen, so for example, here's an example where you say, by the way, I've seen many of you use these kinds of template. It's function name, main, inputs none, outputs none. To me, it's too verbose. And in fact, the people decorated all kinds of colons and, you know, all kinds of spaces and stuff. Make it as compact as possible, right? Because you want to see as much code as possible. Be brief about what you are going to say. So, for example, if it says find combinations, it says uses a subset some problem, right? Or subset some algorithm. So you have a one-line description if you can get away with it. But no, you don't need to. In fact, there should not be a function like that. In this case, it's main. So of course, it has no inputs and no outputs. But in general, if you have no inputs and no outputs, that's a problem to begin with, right? So have as little documentation as possible. I mean, as brief a documentation as possible, but it should be to the point. Anyway, more to the point, when you say testing here it takes a test input path, puts a file name, and for test input, it runs something. And finally, here we come to the nub of the thing, where it says, here you're given a list of digits. Given a list of digits and given a sum, give me a subset of the set of lists, a subset of this list that will yield this particular sum, right? It's a subset sum algorithm. Now, there's a whole lot of boilerplate code here. All this is boilerplate testing code. And in fact, it goes on and on because this is just one round. And then it says, input, do you want to run your script on other text input files if choice is Y? Then basically it does the same thing over and over again. So clearly, all it's doing is it's taking a bunch of files and checking the input and output. Now, all this code is of course eliminatable, completely eliminatable. But the second thing is that you as a tester or as a developer have to come up with a variety of intelligent test cases, and depending on your biases, you might not, you know, if you're not very comfortable with testing, then you tend to go light on the system. You don't like, you know, you don't like throw, you know, complete automation at it, right? So you, in these cases, you are actually better off with what is called fuzz testing. So fuzz testing is the concept is simple. It generates random inputs and makes program crashes makes the program crash, or it fail make it fail assertions, right? So it'll keep generating inputs, and there are some of these fuzzers are really very, very intelligent. They do all kinds of binary searches. They keep old state from earlier runs, and they keep narrowing down the problems to see where they could change the input of a function to create either an unacceptable exception or to trigger an assertion failure. So there are two kinds of fuzzers. One is called a mutation fuzzer, and the other kind is called a generation fuzzer. And mutation fuzzer, you have to give it a certain set of valid inputs. For example, suppose you are testing, let's say an image manipulation library. You give it a bunch of images and say, this is how I'm validating whether this particular function is right or not. And looking at that image, that data, this mutation fuzzer will make all kinds of changes to the data and try to trigger a crash. So it's possible that it might just give it half the file, right? So a library that says here the length of the file, but it actually gets only half the content is likely to fail, right? So given a bunch of core data, it doesn't need much, it'll create a whole lot more tests. So there is a fantastic, it's a truly impressive testing tool called American Fuzzy Lop. It's a weird name, but it turns out that American Fuzzy Lop is a kind of a rabbit. The whole thing is covered in like this woolly fuzz. So it's fuzz testing. So this whole fuzz testing tool, they have all kinds of rabbit names, interesting rabbit names. So American Fuzzy Lop is one such tool, and it has, you have to see the kinds of errors it has caught in all the databases, in the Linux kernel, in Google Cloud infrastructure, in all the browsers. And in just the last few years, it caught something like 12,000 bugs, security bugs in Google Chrome alone. It's an insanely fantastic tool. So AFL, it's called, American Fuzzy Lop. There is another kind of fuzzer, which is called a generation fuzzer, which generates randomized inputs from scratch. So essentially, it's an object in a language that's basically going to generate random data. But it's not completely random. It's controllable, right? So let me show you something called hypothesis in Python. So let's see if I can get this. So I say from hypothesis, so I'll say import hypothesis. From hypothesis, import strategies as ST. So there are many strategies that hypothesis has. So testing strategies, that is. So let me come up with a testing strategy for integers. So essentially, this is a source of random integers. So I can say int SQL st.integer, right? So if I say int.example, if I say int.example versus zero, okay. So it's clearly oriented towards boundary testing. So it gives zero as a first thing that it tries. So zero is likely zero, and some higher bound are likely to come up more. Let's see if I keep doing it. Let's say if I print 20 of them, int.example. So here you can see many zeros, but also random numbers, including negative numbers. So it's possible that your library has not taken negative numbers into account, and suddenly when it's fed with this particular number, it might crash. So here's a way of how you use it actually in practice. Here's a testing example for the same test combinations thing. So find combinations, this is the part that I had to test. So what I do is I write a test method, which takes a list of digits and a number to strive towards. And what I'm going to do is use a annotation called given. So it says given a list of integers. So st.list, strategies.list, given, so list of integers, sorry, it's nested strategies here. So the inner strategy says I'm going to generate a stream of ints from between 1 and 9. And the outer strategy says I'm going to take that and create arbitrary length lists, but max size 10. And the second parameter, which is the num parameter, I'm going to give it an integer between 1 and 2000. Okay. So just doing this, if I run the tool like PyTest, PyTest is a tool that comes with Python, and it looks at a particular file and says all the methods, all the functions that start with a test, it'll invoke it. So in this case, it'll find test combinations, and it'll give it a stream of digit lists and corresponding numbers and some number, and you have to ensure that either it returns the sum of the combination of the digits is what is specified, what is the input, or it was not able to find a combination, in which case the sum is zero, right? This assertion hopefully should not fail at all. Now, one of the things that the test framework also has is a timeout. So in case it went into an infinite loop, or let's say it ran out of stack because you're doing some recursive procedure and it just went haywire, then you would have, it would trigger an issue like this. Okay, so here you have an example which combines a lot of these things, where you have find combination which only takes its input, and based on that it produces an output, and that is completely testable. And we are not writing any test code, we are just writing a little bit of scaffolding, but all the data is coming from these strategies. You can write custom strategies as well. Okay, so here's how you eliminate code by making the machine work for you. This is the last bit. Do I have a last bit? Yes. It's the last bit, Kavi, if I don't mind, I'll just go with this.
Yeah. Please go ahead.
Yeah. The last bit about eliminating code is that there are many, many times the many pieces of code which say, for example, move forward 10, then turn right 90, then soft left, pick, move, whatever. There's all kinds of instructions that you're giving to the robot, and that's all completely hard coded, right? Now, it's wonderful to make peace, or wonderful to sort of have this, the exec command in Python, it should be in your arsenal. So what exec does is, for example, if I say p equals, suppose I have a string that looks like this. It's a program fragment, okay? And let's say x equals 10. If I say exec this program, I have executed a string, and the new value is 410, right? So essentially what it's able to, the Python interpreter is able to, because it's doing things dynamically anyway, you can have code at runtime. Now the way you use it is you can now have code, you can have a Python interpreter, like a micro Python interpreter running in the bot. And you can now have over the air updates, you can send it new commands. And in fact, you can define functions. You can do whatever you want in a Python program, right? You can define functions. You can have composite functions saying, for example, you can say, skip the next three nodes, right? So that is composed of move past, look for the next node three times, and then turn a right, or something like that, right? So you have this entire definition of the primitives, which is go all the way to the next node, and execution of that, all pushed to the robot. So the laptop is merely supplying code. So it's like a remote, it's like a stored procedure call in a database. It's happening on the node, right? And all these interpreters are MicroPython, very, very light. I think it's something like less than 10K in size. I may be mistaken, but it's not really that big. It's very, very small size. Maybe 100K at the most. bytes. So it's a full-fledged Python interpreter and handles Python 3 nicely along with all the standard library and everything. So essentially the idea is that you could send code, you know, and exec it in the bot. And that's a completely different way of interacting. So you don't need to write any parsing code. You don't have to say, if the command is M, then move forward 20. You don't have to write any parsing code. So that's a way of eliminating code, because there's already Python. It's already can do parsing. So might as well express everything in terms of Python code, right? Instead of you writing your own command. And there are all kinds of systems that use this pattern. Of course, you know that browsers use JavaScript, and Redis uses Lua. I don't know how many of you know Lua, but it's a very, very popular language. It's used in a lot of the games. It actually caught a lot of attention in the games industry. And a whole lot of procedural code is actually written in Lua. And in fact, Redis, which is one of the most well-known in-memory databases around, used all over the world, it extends itself through Lua. So now they don't have to provide any custom code in Redis. They just provide a Lua module, and that's that. Suddenly, the whole database has new capability. Likewise, at Postgres, you can write embedded code in Python, which runs on the server, not on the client. It runs on the server. So these are ways of eliminating code in the sense that you are making the Python interpreter do some work. So that's all I have. There's a whole bunch of techniques, but I cherry-picked a few because of what I was seeing in the code. If you can think of other lovely pieces of ways of working, then feel free to write, and I'll take a look at it as well. Otherwise, thank you for your attention. So a couple of things I would like to mention here. For functional data structures, Chris Okafaki's PhD thesis and his book is just a fantastic read, How to Create Amortized in terms of complexity, very low complex, very efficient data structures. If you don't read anything else in computer science, at the very least, you should read John Bentley's books, Programming Pearl. They are these really thin books. And for a while, over like 10 years, I would keep going back to these books. They're just brilliant pieces of writing. They used to come I forget which one, I think in Byte magazine or Scientific American, I don't know which one, as little articles, but they were all compiled into something called Programming Pearl. It's a fantastic book. And then State Charts and Hypothesis and Persistent. There are many others that we can talk about. Also, make sure that you explore other languages, because languages sort of encapsulate a completely different mindset. So I would highly advise you to learn Erlang, for example, Erlang. Just learn it, and your programming will not be the same again. I can guarantee you. So thank you for your attention, and let's see if you have any energy for questions.
Thanks, Sriram. This is really amazing. Before we say anything else, I'd like everybody to just unmute and show our appreciation for an excellent talk. So there are questions here. Maybe I can get them out to you. These came quite early, actually. Let me see. Yeah, so Pratyush has asked, is there by any chance Max Time Machine keeps track of various versions of files at real time so as to offer backup when needed? He's just wondering, I guess, how that is implemented. Or Pratyush, do you want to ask this yourself?
Yeah, I think I get the question.
Yeah, pretty much you have asked the same, sir. That was my question.
In fact, what Time Machine does on the Mac is, in fact, exactly this. It's a persistent tree. So what it does is that when a new file is created, a completely new content, of course, it creates a node. But if you create a new version of a file, that file is a new file, and it's a new file. But the directory structure, these are all soft links. These ones, back to the old ones, these are soft links. So it's just a combination of hard links and soft links. So here this might be a hard link, but to the earlier version, it's sharing a structure with the earlier version. So the effectively you have two directory structures, but whatever was there in the earlier stuff, it just has to refer to it using a soft link.
Okay, thanks. Ayush Patel has asked a question. He's saying, sir, according to your first point of using pure functions, I have tested it with Python. If using pure function, it slows down the performance. But he says that my test was only for a small script. So does this occur only with interpreted languages or what? Why does it slow down
with
pure functions?
I will first doubt your testing strategy. Because when you say pure functions, you mean you're basically saying all inputs have to map to outputs, right?
Yes, that's how you described it, right?
Right. So in this particular case, I am not saying that you can't use local variables that have mutation in it. But they are only local variables. Nobody on the outside of the function knows about mutation, right? So this pattern is different from immutability. Right? So the idea here is, it's like if you want to say something like a square root, it takes a number and returns you the square root of that number, right? It's very, very clear. Now, that input has to come from somewhere. Whether you're coming from the argument or whether it's coming from a global variable, there is no difference in terms of time taken, right? It's reading one memory location versus another. So there really ought not to be any difference in performance.
So Rishi has asked a question here. He says that software has been a large part of most engineering disciplines for many decades. Unfortunately, the notion that developing good software is not a core skill is still very, very prevalent with engineering students and recent engineers even today. What actions and strategies will you suggest for dispelling this notion without seeing them fall hard and stopping them from perpetuating mediocrity? This is a very low, broad question.
No, I see this. There is this very strange mindset of not giving respect to code, right? What a coder is, low level coder is, right? If you want to progress up in life, you basically become a manager, right? That is the standard outlook. Now, if my life is anything to go by, I have completely shunned all these kinds of value systems. I said, what does it take to become a craftsman, right? Karigar. Like somebody who produces software, or not that I'm doing it, but I'm striving toward it, which are a pleasure to behold, which are a pleasure to use, right? What does it take to do that? And then that goes away from just a coding skill. It's no longer just a coding skill. It is a whole product skill. It's a mindset that says, I need to create this shiny thing, only part of which is actually code. Here's an example. You know, there is a store, IKEA. It has come to India as well, Swedish company. And they sell furniture, right? If you go to their store, right in the middle of the furniture section is this machine, kept right in the middle. It's this machine that is basically stress testing every chair. So what it has basically two pistons. One is pushing the back of the chair and one is pushing the bottom of the chair. And it's basically simulating a 200, 300 pound guy sitting on it, getting up, sitting on it, getting up, right? So it's making this racket, like it's a pneumatic machine. It's making this racket in the middle of the store. And what it tells me is that they're so proud of their testing. You look at it and it says, these guys will put out, I mean, you want to believe me that a 200-pound guy can repeatedly sit on this for 10 years? Here's the proof. We've been doing this as long as the store has been open, this chair has been under stress test. So what that mindset means is that not only is testing important, but the amount of engineering that goes into creating the test rig in the first place. It's as much work as it's designing the chair in the first place. The test rig is as much work. A different product mentality. It's no longer just a coding. It's no longer just an assignment. It's no longer just a project that you're going to use. It is something that somebody else is going to use, and I'm going to demonstrate to you in no uncertain terms how reliable it is. Right? Of course, it looks beautiful. But if you look at it if you look at the store, even the testing room looks beautiful. That is Swedish design for you, a Scandinavian design for you.
Shira, I'm glad you brought this up because this category actually is the heart of any industrial might of any nation, basically, right? Because it's like, for instance, I'm quite fascinated by how they build these large aircraft like Boeings and Airbuses and all that, especially the A380 and things like that. How must they test these planes and the undercarriages and stuff like that? That means they have to build machines that can give them more stress than they will face in the air in order to feel... in order to explore if the components will fail or not. And that itself is a huge science and an art also, you know.
I mean, the Boeing, the largest of the Boeings, the wing goes up and down by a few meters, right? The tip of the wing flexes. I mean, the wing itself flexes so that the tip of the wing basically flexes by when moves up and down by a few meters. So clearly, the wing itself at where it's cantilevered, it's subject to a whole lot of stress. So the way they test it is they have this massive swimming pool where the aircraft is, and the whole thing goes up and down to stress test the wings. Right. So it's amazing what for every single thing, for every single part, how much stress testing goes in it, how much modularity, how much redundancy goes into it. Formal methods, of course, how much randomized testing goes into it. It's quite incredible.
That's interesting.
And the moment you take shortcuts, you have something like this, the Max problem that happened lately.
So Paritosh has a question. What would it take to have an effective component-based design framework for concurrent distributed real-time systems? In the sense that hardware to be built, Java classes allow sequential code to be composed very well.
Yeah, so the biggest thing is that when we think of Java code, or at least our training, is very, very procedural. And in many of these systems, you have to be much more reaction-oriented, whether it's hardware, whether it is writing servers, whether it's operating systems or database servers or web servers, all of these are reacting to inputs from external entities. So you have to frame yourself into thinking in a state machine style, and that's where tools like Esterel really shine, because they are producing, not only are they producing state machines, but they also have a model for in what order, it's a very deterministic order, how are the external events assimilated, and in what way are the events processed? So in Esterel or in this paradigm, what you might have is you take a snapshot of the hardware. For example, you take a snapshot of all the sensors, then you run the state machine through one cycle and see all the actions that it has to take and perform those actions. Then on to the next cycle. Take a snapshot of the hardware, do everything. So in this way, what happens is that you are able to make global state machine assertions about what properties remain true, or what are invariants and what have broken invariants, and so on.
It's quite interesting, Shriram, that you're talking just the language that we do, because in the embedded systems course, we teach model-based design, and the two paradigms that we teach there are Esterel for describing these systems at a high level of abstraction, and state charts,
yes,
right? And we've also been working with the Yakindo tool, actually, to derive the code, okay? And this is something that we are hoping to, this course, we want to release to the eYantra labs as a MOOC, right? So that's quite interesting. One very interesting data point is that with Paritosh, we wrote a paper a few years ago where we would describe a system. This was a self-parking robot with the Firebird robot that we have. So it goes along a white line, it avoids obstacles. So there are a number of states that it can be in. And then when it finds a free parking slot, it goes and parks. So we found, this was done by a couple of BE students from Xavier's College, right, where we conceptualized the system using state charts, And then we hand translated the state chart code to C. And we found that it was so much easier to test, debug, change, modify, all these things. So I think we are doing exactly what you wanted to do here. But
In fact,
using this kind of thinking. So your whole thing is about a very disciplined way of thinking, and you're using state charts inherently in your kind of or reactive state machines in your
In
way
fact,
of thinking.
one of the problems that I have with Yakindo is that the semantics are unclear. So, for example, if I say if I raise an event, that means if I produce an action for the outside world, at what point is that action, does that action take place? Now, in Estherel, it's very clear. It says it's only on the next cycle. So any state changes that I make, any actions that I take, will not happen in this cycle. So it's a very stable background. It's a stable computational framework where you can say, based on this state, I want to do the following things. And before the next cycle starts, the appropriate changes would have been made, and now you're on to the next cycle. Yakindo does not do that. It does not clarify what the restrictions are or how it's going to process a particular event. So, for example, there's one troubling thing that I read where if you have two state machines and if one of them has already taken an action, the other state machine can actually see that change, which means that depending on the order in which these two state machines are processed, it might be different behavior. It is no longer predictable.
Shriram,
That's
if I
interesting.
may
There are two.
interrupt, if I may interrupt,
Please.
may I?
Yeah, Paritosh, bolo.
You must.
So, Shriram, yes, I think you are right. The weaknesses with state chart, although its visual part is good, but there are alternative languages, like SCADE, Lustre, or Heptagon, where there is no such semantic unambiguity.
Absolutely.
And even compilation is much better because of that.
That's right. Because it's an entirely different mindset which takes time into account, whereas state
Right.
charts does not take time into account.
Right.
Right.
Thanks for a very, very, very interesting discussion.
So I worked on a language called Bloom, which is a variant of Datalog, which is a logic way of expressing the same invariance. So there is the notion of in this cycle versus, I mean, run to a fixed point in this cycle, make
Right.
propagate all the changes in this cycle, and then there is the notion of make all these changes for the next cycle.
Okay. Wonderful.
So
You
that whatever rules you have, they become order independent. And so it
Okay.
doesn't matter in which order you write the code, in which order the
Right.
events came, whatever events are there for this cycle are processed in an order independent fashion and produce results for the next round. So it's completely monotonic. It's beautiful.
Thanks.
This is the start of a conversation. I think we'll have you also on the embedded systems course next. Okay, there's a question here from Kavya Mulya. Hey, Kavya, why don't you just unmute yourself? You ask it yourself.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Thank you for such an insightful talk. Like we would surely see that we won't repeat the mistakes we made. So you told about execute EXEC, which helps in on-fly programming. Sir, but I didn't understand how can I actually tell the robot to go left, like without actually writing the code.
So you have to write the code, but now you are writing, let's say, Python code,
Okay.
but the code that you are not writing is the all the command parsing part. So let me take a different example. Okay, suppose you were to write a forget robots. Suppose you were writing a plotting package. Okay. And
Okay.
I tell you, your plotting package has to be able to plot all functions, all math functions, sine, cos, tan, log, 1 by x, whatever.
Yes.
How would you write it? Would you write a parser for this language? whatever language you create, you say y equals sine x or y equals sine of x cube, sine cube x plus cos squared x. Would you write a parser for this expression?
No.
The way I would do it is to say wrap it in a for loop wrap it in a function. I'll say for x equals 0 to whatever, say 2 pi or 0 to 10 pi.
Okay.
Whatever function you typed, I will just say y equals that function, right?
Yes.
And just execute that loop. So Python does all the hard work of parsing that expression. I didn't write anything. It understands what sine, it can compute sine of x cube, you know, sine cube x plus cos squared x plus log of x. It can compute that expression because it already has that stuff inbuilt. I didn't have to do any expression parsing, any command parsing. I didn't have to write anything about loops. All that stuff was done automatically for me.
Basically, I'm giving the input that function itself, and the Python code is like executing it.
Exactly. So essentially, what you're doing is one way to make this fast is say, suppose you are given this expression, okay? Y equals say sine cube x plus cos squared x. Okay. Suppose the user types this expression. I don't know what this expression is.
Yes.
Okay. But he doesn't even give y equals, right? Suppose he just says sine cube x plus cos squared x. All I know that it's got x somewhere in between, right? That is the dependent variable, independent variable. Yes. That's what is applied. So what I do is I put a y equals in front of this in the string. So I now have a string which is y equals whatever expression that guy gave me. Okay.
Yes.
I call a function called compile. It gives me now a compiled version, an object which is a compiled version of this expression.
Yes, I understand. Yes.
Now it's given me a function which takes an x and whatever the return value is a y. So now I can basically give it a whole bunch of parameters, give it to this function, get back a y, and just plot it.
Yes, sir, understood. Sir, one more question. Like, we are working on test-driven development project. Can you share some insights, like how to write mock functions or test functions?
See, the thing is, oftentimes, when you don't have side effects, you reduce the need for mock functions. If you have built-in mock functions,
yes.
Then, like for example, turn on in the code, then you have to have a mock function to turn on because you don't have hardware. If you didn't have turn on at all, if it was a pure function, then it can be completely tested on its own. So the idea is that if you test it from inside out, and if you test the basic part, and then you are completely certain that that basic part is not dependent on any external stuff. It's only dependent on the input that you give it. And if it is called by an outside function, that too is supplying, that also is a pure function, then the only way the inside function is getting its arguments is from the outside function, right? It can't get it from anywhere else. So now you don't have to mock the inside part at all. So you only have to basically test function by function until you are getting to an enough big enough stage where it becomes more like a system test rather than a unit test.
So this is a very interesting idea. So Shiran, this is basically the power of functional programming, right? Where functional programming it says that you can take a large expression and replace a function inside it, deep inside it, with something which is proven to be equivalently equivalent to that, and you're guaranteed that the entire infrastructure will have the same behavior.
Yeah. And yes, exactly right. Exactly
so,
right.
So that's where it comes from. Yeah, Kavya, bolo. Kavya, your audio is not very good at the moment. Anyway, I think we should move on. So both Sriram and Paritosh here, we are having views of these projects on Sunday. No, on Sunday it is. Yes, it'll be great if you can kind of join us for that. So you'll see what kind of things tomorrow? That these folks are actually doing.
Is it tomorrow?
Tomorrow. Okay. Yes.
Just send the schedule.
We'll come to that. So there's a question by Kalin here. Hey, Kalin, do you want to unmute yourself and ask?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes.
Kind of. If you speak up a bit, you'll be more audible.
Hello, am I audible now?
Now you're audible.
Okay. Sir, I'm like thankful to the suggestions and the comments that you had actually given on the EYRC course. Like you had gone through them, and it's a kind of a learning experience for even the theme developers, because I had two questions though. We are like the ones that you had shown about the fine combinations one, like to find out the subset of sum of subsets from a list of digits. So over there, like for example, when a student writes a code and we are actually writing a kind of a test case so that we can check their code at their end itself. So like what should be a kind of a strategy? Like should we just check the list of, I mean the checks, for example, whatever they are outputting is the correct data type and the value is correct and so on and so forth, or like whatever test cases that we are providing to them should be like submitted to a server and over there it should be like automatically evaluated at that over there.
Yeah,
so
I would
mainly, yeah, so just one second. So mainly like what happens is we have many students in like in the stage one, but due to this kind of a test casing, like test cases which we provide to them, and if it doesn't generate a valid output, they are actually not getting evaluated. So the number of participants gets in decreasing, the amount of people who are actually crossing through the next stage.
Okay, yeah, so I think the better there might be other ways to handle it, whereas for example support on a forum where you say, if somebody says this is not working for me, I'm just not getting any output, then somebody else can possibly help them out, from maybe from past teams or mentors from
other teams
or winners.
Yeah.
So if every time you have that and somebody, a bunch of people can answer them questions and sort of hold their hands, they'll say, they don't feel alone, especially all this stuff is getting done under deadline pressure. And
yeah.
You feel all the more alone that it's not working, just hard code something, get rid of it. But that is only encouraging last minute, short term thinking.
In fact, this is a longer discussion which we can take offline. The whole issue here is we are beginning to auto-evaluate and auto-grade the code which these guys write remotely, right?
Yeah.
So they can get immediate feedback whether their code is doing the right thing or not, right? So we'll come back to that. That's a longer discussion which we need to have at length, okay? So there's Gaurav Shahani. He just asked the question. Do you want to unmute yourself and ask it yourself? Gaurav?
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, you are.
Sir, I want to know that what I am doing is right now I am creating a decentralized application through using blockchain. So what I am doing is I have to communicate between the two languages, for example, Python and Golang. So is it possible to connect both the languages?
Python and Golang?
Yeah.
There is a way. I've seen it in the past, but I don't know the details.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So here's the thing. From Go to Python is possible. That is, you can embed the Python interpreter within Go. Not a problem at all. But whether a Go program can call a Python function, that I'm not sure.
Okay. Right now, what I'm doing is I'm just calling the CMD and just like os.system and then
If you have to embed a Python program, that definitely can be done because Python is designed to be an embeddable language. So yeah, there is API for that. It's very, very straightforward.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Good. So Arjun, you had a comment, right?
Yeah, that was just a casual thing. First of all, thank you so much, sir. It was very inspirational and insightful. And second, I just thought maybe those flight wing stories that you mentioned and the IKEA's seat story that you mentioned was pretty interesting and very convincing that you should do this methodology of thinking and all that, right? So do you have more stories like that is what I was wondering.
I have tons of stories.
Okay, then.
So I have more stories than time.
Okay. So anyway, that means that there are lots of reasons to have him come back.
I have to give you one. This one story since you asked.
Yeah.
So I wrote the first distributed transaction manager for Java, and back then Java was in 1997. Java was used only on browsers, right? It was just for doing applets and stuff. But we at WebLogic were the first to demonstrate it as a language on the server side. And we were taking on the big boys like IBM and Microsoft and all these people by writing a transactional engine that will drive all these distributed databases. So one of the things that the transactional engine does is write to disk to make sure, because it's writing a log to disk. And the transaction log is a very important part of its functionality. And we had tested it too, in and out. And then we went to demo it at a conference. And we demonstrated it was a huge hit. And one of the audience participants said, so what happens if the disk fails? And at that time, we still had these machines with a floppy disk. You know, you can remove the disk completely. So we said, my colleague, he basically said, what he did was he said, okay, we will configure the transaction log to write to the disk. And while it is writing, I'm going to pop the disk out, right? And you will get a feel for how well it's been engineered, right? So you were 100% confident that that case has been accounted for. And so he does that and insert the disk, configures it so that the log is written to the floppy. And while the transaction is being written, he just pops the disk out. So the transaction basically fails, as it should. And then when he popped the floppy back in, the system recovered to the before state. So nothing was done half-assed. Like, you know, the whole concept of a transaction is that either it's either done or it's either not done or fully done. Right? No in between, no partial state. And so we demonstrated that no change, it was it recovered back to the earlier state just fine. And so this was a demo. And later on, that marketing guy came and told us, never, ever, ever do this in front of me again, because you gave me a heart attack. You never change the script, because demos are the hardest environment for any product. The moment you're going to demo it, somehow the cosmos knows that you're giving a demo, and that's when it decides to fail. So you don't take any chances. You only do the things that I told you to demo. But we were so sure of our testing strategies, we said, okay, we'll see what happens. So we thought that even if we had failed, the audience will see that we were confident in our testing strategies. And it's possible it might have uncovered a bug, but they saw the confidence. And fortunately for us, it worked too.
Oh, excellent.
That is the level of confidence that students should have in their code when they come for the competition, I guess.
Absolutely.
That's pretty amazing. Yeah.
It's a bit much to ask, because they are not writing a product. They are trying to win a competition. But yeah. Some of these engineering principles, because you can go endlessly testing it. But some of these principles, right, like, for example, property-based testing, like this first testing, you should be able to use it, right? You should not have to write any test code. Let generate all kinds of random things. Let it run for 2 days. Why not? Right? Millions of tests you run. Just run it overnight. And for all you know, it might come up with a test case that you never thought of.
Excellent. Shriram, there's a last question here from Shriya. Hey, Shriya, do you want to unmute yourself and ask it yourself? Because this is a very representative question which many people will have in their minds right now after your talk.
So, sir, thank you for the talk. And
Why don't you unmute your video also, so there'll be, so we'll see that there's an actual somebody there asking a question.
No, I think then the voice won't be clear.
Okay, go on.
So, sir, we have now you spoke about so many languages. Even we know about so many languages that there, this language, that language, for a robot takes different things, different languages. So from where should we start? As a newbie who does not know anything, like someone who has just completed 10th, so from where should that person start?
Okay, so there are, well, it depends on what is it that interests you, right? If your interest is in mobile programming, let's say, okay, you should learn Kotlin. I don't know if you've heard of Kotlin. Have you? Kotlin.
No, I haven't.
It's a wonderful language, particularly for Android. But it's a general purpose language. It targets a Java virtual machine. Kotlin, you should learn if you want to do mobile programming. It's a wonderful language. If you are doing say embedded stuff, then you should learn Esterel. Okay, Esterel. There is a whole bunch of these languages. Professor Paritosh and Professor Kavi are in a far better state to tell you about that than I. They have hardcore experience on that. If you have to do, say, web programming, I'll highly recommend Erlang, E-R-L-A-N-G, E-R-L-A-N-G, Erlang, or a variant of that called Elixir, E-L-I-X-I-R, which runs on the Erlang virtual machine. And it's, there are a whole bunch of principles in that language that are just utterly fascinating. So just to give you an example, one of the principles in Erlang is let it fail. So you never write any failure code, because the idea is that the more code you write, the more bugs you introduce. So don't catch errors. Let it fail, reboot. Right? Now the whole idea is that the system is oriented towards coming back to a stable state extremely fast, which means it reboots in the order of nanoseconds, maybe microseconds. It reboots to microseconds. Okay, so you can it's like tripping a circuit breaker, and somebody turns the circuit breaker on, and back you are back in business, right? So you don't have to write any code for error handling. And if you know, error handling is like 80% of any real product, and suddenly a whole bunch of this code just goes away because you know a way to officially reboot, right? This is the kind of thing that we do manually in Windows. If it shows a blue screen, then you reboot. But here you have an official way of doing it. And it does completely, the way you architect these systems is suddenly changes, right? So Erlang is something that will teach you functional programming. And once you do that and you come back to C++ or whatever, Java or Kotlin or whatever, the way you approach it will be different. If you are writing, say, systems code in C++, I would highly advise you to look at Rust as an alternative, right? There are features in the type system that make error-free mutation and error-free aliasing possible. So you can, it's a hard, the compiler is a hard task to please, but if the compiler says it's okay, those errors will not arise anymore, right? And the many, many, many common errors that are there, which, you know, reusing pointers, you deallocate a pointer, and you deallocate an object and you use that pointer again, that's a sure sign of a crash or some random behavior. That will never happen in Rust. So if you're a hardcore C++ kernel kind of hacker work you want to do, then Rust is an alternative that you should look at, and it's available to work on, there are drivers for it for embedded systems as well.
Thanks for this very patient answering of questions. There's one last one here from Gaurav. He's saying, any suggestions as to what language will be used to create the operating system, or how to get started with that?
So what languages to use for operating system? What's the minimal language that you can... I don't think to create an operating system... Okay, so there are a bunch of projects based on the QEMU emulator. Okay, QEMU basically emulates a raw Intel box, just the pure hardware. So you're basically starting from scratch. And if you search for writing an operating system from scratch in Rust, or writing an operating system from scratch in C, there are a whole number of whole set of these projects. In fact, if you look for writing an operating system in Rust, then you will get in early on the action because there are not too many people doing that, and these are all just still at the, you know, prototypical stage. So you might actually contribute something that's actually worthwhile. So it'll help you to learn both operating systems as well as Rust.
So there's a question here called, where exactly can Scala be used?
So Scala is used wherever the Java ecosystem is used. So for wherever you might use a Java application is where Scala is used. I like Scala a lot, but I prefer Kotlin. Kotlin is a sort of a Scala with 80% of the features that I want, probably even 90% of the features that I want. I find Scala to be a much, much more complex language. Kotlin is much simpler. In fact, the transition from it is what I feel Java should have been. Java syntax, they have no excuses at all, given how much work had already been done in functional languages and in, you know, in all the facilities that you are typically used to using in functional languages. For example, pattern matching and things like that. Those were available, you know, in OCaml, in Haskell, in all kinds of languages. There is no good reason why the Java guys did not use that. Absolutely no good reason. And the only reason I can think of is that in the US, they are still stuck in the C++ mold, whereas Europe has moved far, much farther. So if you look at all these languages, they are coming, you know, all these exotic languages, they're all coming from Europe, whether it's Erlang, Scala, Haskell, Miranda, you name it. They're all coming from Europe. Whereas the US guys have this, you know,
macho,
built in my garage kind of mentality. Let's get it out there. But because they have the money to push this through and create a glitzy story around it, that becomes a standard, de facto. Right? In fact, Java was originally meant to be an embedded language, an embedded scripting language, for set-top boxes, right? That was the reason the VM was created. And people like me took it and put it on the server. But it was meant to be a compact language. There is no good reason why they could not have had it, had a much better syntax. And to me, Kotlin encapsulates both the syntax and the facilities of a vastly simplified Scala, which does most of the work.
So Sriram, this has been really fascinating, and I think everybody is really appreciated what you've said, and I'm quite surprised by the maturity and the variety of questions that we've got.
Yes.
And it reminds me, wherever functional programming is discussed, right, they talk about George Orwell, and who deeply believed in the fact that language influences the thought that you express in the language, right? So if you have poor languages, then the thoughts that you express are very poor, and if you have a great language, the thoughts that we can express are much greater and more nuanced. I think that's what you also expressed in this, that language is basically a computer language is a tool. So, but it's very important to have a disciplined approach to whatever you do, right? And the language is just comes out of that very disciplined approach, and there's no need to be married to one particular language, right? Because
no, for me,
so many options.
So for me, the reason why I go into different languages is because they encapsulate certain patterns of thinking of engineering systems. For example, in Haskell, you have, I don't know how many people here might know Haskell, but there is this notion of, you know, a pure state machine. It came from Haskell. I learned it from Haskell. I said, oh my God, this language does not have side effects. So if it doesn't have side effects, what good is a programming language? And finally, the whole objective of a programming language of a system is to have an effect. But if the entire code does not have any side effects, then what does it even mean? If everything is immutable, then nothing is changing. That means the program is not doing anything. It's a very expensive room heater, that's all. Right? But what it finally meant was that it's very, very controlled mutation, and that control is in the hands of the compiler, it's in the hands of the language, not in your hands. And that completely changes the way you look at your architecting. So once you work on Haskell and you come back, you borrow a bunch of those patterns and say, okay, how can I apply it into the language that I actually use? So finally, in production, you might just use one or two, but you're borrowing the ideas and these vocabulary and these patterns from a whole bunch of other ways of thought.
So I think the most important thing that you illustrated here, coming back to it, all those languages are very beautiful. Right. Yeah. And you also brought it back that you know, if something is beautiful, it can also be functional. And it can be much beautiful things are typically more reliable also, because a person has gone beyond functionality into beauty.
Yeah, because it's not just a visual beauty, or you know, it's not just a sensorial beauty. It's a warm fuzzy feeling that you say, ah, this is too good, right? Like, you know, you could be looking at a piece of API and say, wow, this is beautifully engineered. And it's just the interaction with it makes you, like, you want to wake up in the morning. The first thing you want to do is call this API.
So one important message which has come across, which I've been talking so often in all our talks and all this, beauty only happens when you're passionate about it. Yep. Right? The importance of passion in life. So I'd like to thank you all. Sriram, this has been a real eye-opener. People who have not fully understood what you've said will realize it as time goes on when they build more and more systems. What you've said is really very exciting, very, very important, and very inspiring. So thanks a lot for having shared your time and spent all this time. I'd like to give you a big hand from all of us again. So please unmute and show our appreciation to Professor Sriram.
I'll share this link with you, Kavi.
Please do.
And for the students or anyone, feel free to reach out to me by email if you have follow-ups. Just feel free to reach out.
But what I'd like them to do is that they're all going to fill a feedback form. If they can put their questions in there, that'll be nice also. And then we can bring it to you. But we want to see lots of the feedback on this.
Very good.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, Sriram.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the opportunity.
Good night, all. Take care.
Bye-bye.